Welcome to Salisbury University on the Air, a program highlighting the activities and the people of the campus. I'm your host, Susan Purnell. We live in an ever-changing world, and Salisbury University understands the need to evolve with the times and the interests of the student body. In the past year, SU has added three new majors and multiple minors and made adjustments to current programs based on the challenges of COVID-19. Here to discuss with me via Zoom some of the recent additions and changes to Salisbury University's academic offerings is Provost and Senior Vice President of Academic Affairs, Dr. Karen Olmstead.
My pleasure, Susan.
Always a pleasure to see you as well. You know, I've always been impressed with the way that SU is able to adapt to the changing environment, and we've certainly had a lot of changes lately. I'm wondering, how often do you have to regroup and think about ways of changing the academic curriculum?
Well, that's a great question. It's not quite as often as you might think, because we have programs like chemistry or physics or English that are, you know, they're just programs that we always go on with, but it's an ongoing process constantly that we look at our curriculum. We're always looking at workforce needs, hearing student interests, but every 7 years we have a pretty formal process where we look at our majors, and then we have external reviewers come in and take a look at them, as well as accrediting bodies. So we always make sure that what we're doing is really well aligned with best practices and workforce needs.
And where did the ideas come from? Did they come from the students or the faculty or a little bit of both?
Yeah, I mean, really all of the above. I mean, I guess one real big driver of it is workforce needs in Maryland. We certainly are very responsive to that. Students and their families, a lot of times they'll talk about programs they're interested in, and we want to be responsive to that as long as they're sustainable. And then faculty as well often have great ideas, you know, particularly around minors and things like that, that they think will be very innovative and that we can try out and then maybe grow into a major. So, it's not just changes in our major and minors, but it could also be the structure of a major. So do we need to add an internship? Do we need to add some community-based learning? So it's really an ongoing process of review to learn about what our programs are doing and how effectively are they meeting those student learning goals.
I know that one of the new majors is called Outdoor Education Leadership. And I know it's been around also as a minor, but now it's a major. What made you go from minor to major?
Well, we had seen a growth in demand for the minor, and so that's always a good indication that there might be student interest there. Certainly where we live provides opportunities for that minor, but the Outdoor Education Leadership major, as the minor did, is a great program in terms of rounding out student skills for learning about the environment, learning a lot about leadership, learning about risk mitigation, learning about logistics. And so many of those skills are transferable really to any industry, just not environmental and tourism related industries. So we think it'll be a very popular new major, just like it was a popular minor.
I can't imagine any place better than SU and here on the Eastern Shore to have this kind of a major.
Exactly. I mean, we really want to take advantage of the Atlantic coastal beaches, the bay, the tidal rivers, the great biking opportunity. We really wanted to leverage that asset and our location as a real asset to this program.
It really is. My children in this crazy pandemic time have been going and doing exploring all the bike trails around, and they should become a photography book, because
it's so beautiful.
It really is. One big area of expansion has been in the minors, as I think you hinted. Why are these courses so important to the students?
Well, employers, as you might guess, are really looking for a broad skill set in our students. And so sometimes in the major, it's hard to, even with a general education curriculum, it's hard to flesh out all of those areas, you know, ranging from content that might be in the major, maybe in healthcare or business or in science. But then we also need to build on students' communication skills, their writing skills, their problem-solving skills, their team-building skills. And so minors really allow students to complement their majors and round them out. So, you know, there might be a minor that focuses on cultural competency or a minor that focuses on communication. And that really is a value to students who are in different fields where that might not be as emphasized quite as much.
And one of the recently announced minors is that of deaf studies. Mm-hmm. Is there really a growing need for students with the expertise in the American Sign Language and in the deaf culture?
So yeah, we're really excited about this. This was just recently approved, and there's certainly a growing awareness, I would say, as much as anything, of the needs of the deaf community and the hearing impaired community. And so in terms of hearing impaired individuals, you know, there is a growing population of people with hearing impairment as a result of the normal aging process. So it's certainly great that we have students that are going to have the opportunity to learn about that. I mean, you can imagine a student in social work or nursing or really any healthcare field, just like learning Spanish or learning Haitian Creole would complement their ability to deliver services right here on the Eastern Shore, so would their ability to work effectively with the deaf community or the hearing impaired. But I also heard of a student who's interested, she's in the business school, Purdue School of Business. She's interested in supporting deaf-owned and deaf-serving businesses. And so she would get a lot out of a minor like this, learning more about deaf culture and the hearing impairment.
I've been thinking I need to learn American Sign Language, because as I realize as I get older, my hearing is getting more impaired. So it might be good for all of us to
all of us have more understanding of it, for sure.
Right. So many of the biggest challenges facing society require for our graduates to combine skills. I think you said that a little bit earlier, and have knowledge in more than just one specific area. What can you tell us about the new health humanities minor?
Yeah, this is a really exciting one. And it grew out of our faculty learning communities, where faculty get together and talk about the curriculum and what they can do to, you know, to grow it and to make it even more valuable to students. So this particular faculty learning community included folks from the humanities, particularly philosophy, social sciences, healthcare, different healthcare faculty. And they took a look at wellness, health, medicine, healthcare from a 360 perspective. So, you know, when you think about American healthcare or healthcare generally, it's not just the medicine, it's wellness practices. It's how do you convince people to behave in a way that's proactively healthful? You know, that whole, how do you motivate human behavior? Big questions around death and dying. You know, those are as much philosophical questions as they are related to medicine. And then culturally responsive healthcare. Is there a way that you can communicate with patients that resonates with them more than if you just have one approach? So I'm so excited about this minor. I think it really will serve our students well as they enter the healthcare arena and allow them to be more effective in delivering that.
It's great that you're so responsive. Also within the Fulton School of Liberal Arts, there's a new music production minor, which I guess talks about what happens behind the scenes in putting on any kind of musical production. With the state of the arts recording and editing capabilities over at Conway Hall, I guess this seems like a really good opportunity for many students.
It really is. And it allows us, I think, to more fully leverage those state-of-the-art facilities that you mentioned in Conway Hall. You know, SU is already really well known for our performing arts, although sadly this semester we've not been able to do as much as we normally do. But, you know, our students routinely win singing competitions. We have amazing theatrical productions. Our students participate in any number of music ensembles in the Salisbury Symphony Orchestra. But that's really only one piece of music, right? There's the production piece as well. And so students who are interested in that, that's a great way for them to learn those skills and really enter the music industry, a variety of careers by having that technical expertise for behind the scenes.
With all of these programs that we've spoken about today, there are a lot of choices for SU students, but not everybody coming into college knows exactly what they want to do. Mm-hmm. What options are available for those students who just don't know what they want to go into?
Yeah, I think for families that and students that are looking at college, particularly that are, you know, in high school, the traditional college student, everybody feels this incredible pressure to pick a major. And yet the largest major, or not major, but designation of our students when they come in for first year students is undecided, because students really don't know. You know, they're 17 or 18 years old. And I always tell them, you don't know what you don't know. You might find a major that you never heard of. You might love something you never heard about before. Certainly that was the case for me in college. And so I think it's really important that we expose them to the variety of careers that are out there, kind of work backwards mm-hmm. and help them pick majors and minors that get them there. So doing that though isn't an easy thing. It's where we have a pretty well-structured program out, run out of our academic advising center, the exploratory studies program, where students are exposed to majors, exposed to career fields and the types of majors that can get you there. So if you want to be a physician, you can still do that through a history major. You just, the path is a little bit different. It exposes them to the variety of programming that we have here, but also, and I think most importantly, it allows them to assess their own skills and interests and understand, you know, would I want to go to professional school? Would I want to go to a graduate program? Do I want to have an internship? You know, what types of general areas am I interested in, or do I want to learn more about? So we're really excited to have that on board. And not just have it called, you know, not decided. It's a real program.
Exploratory studies.
I like
that. That's great. You know, with this COVID pandemic, the one thing that has been shot, I'm supposed to be in Italy right now, just by the way. It's supposed to go now again in April, and I don't know if that's going to happen. But, you know, you have had so many programs that involve international travel. How have you adjusted to this new environment?
Yeah, I have to say, from a, you know, kind of a the grand view, the thing that has been crushed maybe the most is our globalization efforts as a result of COVID. You know,
that would make sense.
Yeah, we had to pull our students back, just like you're saying. You're not able to travel. Our study abroad students weren't able to pursue that. So, you know, that at a moment it was like, well, I guess we can't do anything in that area. But then Brian Stiegler, who's our assistant provost for international education, and his staff did just an amazing job of thinking about how can we globalize our education here at SU without travel, without having our students go anywhere, and without having students from abroad come here. Although we still have a couple hundred students on campus that are international students. And so they're doing things like global seminars where our faculty and faculty from other institutions around the world and Costa Rica, France, wherever, co-teach courses. So students from both campuses are in those sections. We also have discussion opportunities for students who are learning English and our students who are learning another language, perhaps Spanish, communicate together, which is really a really exciting thing. And then we're just focused on our English Language Institute is delivering English instruction virtually to students in China. So we're trying to maintain all of that and that momentum, but within the reality that we can't travel right now. And so that's really hard, but our goal is to be very well positioned to maintain that momentum, maintain those learning outcomes, and be ready to get back out there as soon as we can.
And I hope that will be soon, Karen. Thank you so much.
I hope we all can, yes.
Yes, thank you so much for being with us. And it's really amazing how flexible and quick on your feet you all have been to accommodate this new environment.
Oh, well, thank you. I give full credit to the faculty. They're doing an incredible job.
And the students.
Thank you, Susan. Yep, for sure.
Absolutely. Thank you, Karen. Good to see you.
Thank you. Yeah, bye-bye.
My thanks again to Karen for joining us via Zoom. SU students have the opportunity to participate in research projects along with faculty mentors, sponsored through the Office of Graduate Studies and Research. Let's now take a look at a recent research project that was conducted this summer.
My project this summer is Circles, which is a social identity mapping application. We are working in tandem with the SU Psychology Department, as well as the Geographical Informational Systems Department, or GIS. Our project basically consists of two parts. We started last summer with the beginning of the first part, which was the construction of the web application. Since it's such a heavy, we want to get it perfect the first time. It's taken us about a year to complete the application itself. And then as soon as we're done with that, this upcoming semester is when we will take all the data after the IRB approval and start mapping social identities.
So Grace is working on a graphical interface for people to enter how they visualize their own social identities. What Grace is doing is going to enable us to survey thousands, orders of magnitude more users, and also have a lot easier tools for the data aggregation and data analysis. And so eventually she's going to be working on some the data analytic tools once the survey interface is done.
So the graphic part is the most interesting part to me. The web application is a very very good for computer science students, but what is both psychological and computer science about this is the middle ground kind of is what we call topological data analysis. And it's where you take geographical figures, like, such as circles for this example, but it could be anything like lines, rectangles, but in this case, circles. And we map those relations. So it's like, if this circle overlaps this circle, what does that mean, like, to a person's identity?
One of the really interesting potentials of the project is that it could be of huge interest to pretty much any field in an industrial setting, because a marketer could use this and run the same experiment, but not for social identity, but for, like, products you buy, or, you know, list your top five political ideologies and, you know, put them in circles and color. And so you get it gives a really rich view into how people conceptualize anything you want.
I want to do something like this for my future job career, either full stack development, where I work on web applications, front end and back end, or data analysts, where I would take the data from those kind of applications and turn it into something that companies, the government, anyone could use to help, you know, our population.
These students, their interests, and these projects never cease to amaze me. To learn about other summer research projects that have taken place in 2020, visit www.youtube.com/Salisbury University. Some of these projects fall within the Richard A. Henson School of Science and Technology, which has introduced two new majors recently. Here to speak about these is Dr. Michael Scott, Dean of the Henson School. Michael, so good to have you.
Thank you.
Absolutely. You know, times, they are changing, right? Science, everything is changing. How do you at the Henson School keep up with it all?
Right. I tell you what, the faculty think about that all the time. So indeed, the amount of the speed with which we have innovations and changes in science and technology is a bit head spinning. But this is, of course, what they do for a living, right? So mm-hmm. It's a constant reading of the most recent literature. Normally, in non-COVID times, they would be going to conferences. So you can hear changes, right? You can hear experts in the field talking mm-hmm. about what they've discovered. Most of that's now taking place virtually. They're still having conferences. Everybody's getting together, but not doing it face-to-face. But it is, it's a lot of work to try to keep up with all the changes so that then we can bring that to our students. That's the goal of it.
Right. Now, the most recently added major in the Henson School, I understand, is Integrated Science.
That's correct.
This is a first for the University of Maryland system.
Correct.
Tell me what that means.
So Integrated Science is the idea of not having a particular disciplinary major, like biology or chemistry or mm-hmm. physics, but instead taking courses from a wide variety of majors. And therefore achieving your degree in integrated science. We basically put this together for a couple major reasons. One, it is an important what we call a rescue major. So we have a lot of students who want to be scientists, who are committed to being scientists, but often run into a course or two that for whatever reason they just can't get past.
And so, chemistry for me.
Yeah, for example, right. A lot of people, it's organic chemistry is one. There's a bunch of them. So the trouble then is a lot of times those students will change their major and become not a scientist, or they'll just leave the university altogether. And we are desperate to create scientists in the state of Maryland. The state of Maryland has one of the most advanced workforces of any state in the nation. We have a tremendous need for working scientists, and so we have a commitment as a public comprehensive university to create as many scientists as we can. And so we are trying to remove some of the burden and the barrier to them accomplishing a degree in science. That's the first reason. The other reason we created it was for veterans. So a lot of times when veterans would come to Salisbury University after they finished their tours of duty, they would have a ton of experience and education that was science and technology focused, mm-hmm. but it didn't usually or always fit particularly well into a particular major because they got their experience all over the place when during their service. So what this was going to allow them to do is apply those science credits and technology credits across the board and actually make sure that when they come to us, we can actually turn them around and get them done with their degree and on with their life as quickly as we can.
That's so interesting. Are they required to combine the sciences only within the Henson School?
No. They are required to make sure they get some upper-level science credits from Henson programs. However, the whole goal of this is to allow students to now build their own science curriculum. So they can go in and go, well, I'm really interested in, let's say, a particular aspect of health plus science. So we're going to encourage them to take advanced courses in the College of Health and Human Services, as well as in the Henson School. Mm-hmm. Or perhaps they're interested in a combination of, say, science and one of our liberal arts. So we would try to combine the courses they need in Henson with courses in the Fulton School of Liberal Arts.
Can you give me some other examples of student programs that you've looked at that you find, you know, are sort of fascinating in terms of how they combine all these courses?
Yeah, absolutely. We've got some students right out of the gate super excited about this. I was just talking to one the other day, for example, who would like to major in nutritional science. Now, we don't have a program in nutritional science at Salisbury, mm-hmm. but we do have courses in Henson and courses in some of the other places that would fit well in a nutritional science program. So we're going to be able to put them together into a program that they can basically craft a nutritional science program underneath integrated science. Another one is neuroscience. That's a big area right now. Study the brain is a major move forward in science in general. And so we're able to, underneath this integrated science curriculum, we can actually pull courses from psychology and from philosophy and from biology and from chemistry to create what we would call a neuroscience program.
I think that's so interesting. So instead of it's make your own Sunday, it's make your own major.
Absolutely.
Right? That's correct. I love that. That's great. Another new major is called data sciences. Tell me a little bit about that.
Yeah, absolutely. This is another one of our major new initiatives in data science. As you might imagine, and certainly your viewers would understand, the world is awash in data. Data coming from social media platforms, data coming from economics, data coming from climate models, all sorts of data. And come to find out, there's of course always been majors in computer science or mathematics mm-hmm. and visualization. But what we have found, and not just us, but other places around the country, have found that this combination of mathematics, computer science, and visualization all come together into what's essentially a new field called data science. Rather than focusing on the manipulation of the mathematics or of the code, it's the manipulation of the data and learning how to mine that data for information that you can then give to business owners or government officials or whatever it happens to be able to make change, right? To be able to effectively make change by evaluating data.
I didn't understand one thing. What's visualization?
So being able to take data and make it visual. So graphs, charts, maps. Any sorts of complex display of data to make it simpler and easier to understand.
And why is this so important at this time to have a data sciences major?
Well, for one thing, we have employers clamoring for it. So I have about two or three employers a month that will call me and go, have you got any of these data science majors? And we need to hire them right away. And unfortunately, we do not yet because we just started the program, but we will soon. And we have the ability for those students to do internships. So we anticipate that they're going to move on to internships in data science very quickly.
So that's the place to go, kids.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
To get hired right out of college,
correct.
Right? Data
Absolutely.
Sciences.
Yep.
What do you think the Henson School is going to explore next?
Well, we got a lot cooking. So one of the big ones and the number one major that we get asked for that we don't yet have at Salisbury is forensics. However, we have a number of faculty in the Henson School that have their specialty is forensics. So we're actually going to be pulling that together and we're going to be looking at it as both a combination of, again, not just chemistry, of which forensics is a bunch, and of course DNA analysis, so biology is a bunch, but also psychology. So we're excited about being able to bring those folks in, of course, because being able to understand the criminal mind, that sort of thing. So we're really excited about that being an interdisciplinary major in forensic science.
Oh, that's really interesting. Well, where do you think science and technology are leading SU?
Well, I tell you what, it's an exciting time to be in the field, obviously, because of all the innovation and change. Mm-hmm. It is a really significant driver, obviously, of economic growth within the state. We're committed to that. We're committed to continuing to try to create as many young scientists as we can and keep them here in Maryland so they continue to work to add to our workforce. And so that's not going to change anytime soon. If you think about all the major issues that we're facing as a country and as a planet, most of them are rooted in science.
They really are. I'm amazed. I guess all we can count on is change in life.
And that's true.
It's great that you are accommodating that here at SU with all the different courses and the new offerings that you have.
Absolutely.
So great to talk to you, Mike.
Yes, thanks for having me.
Take care. Stay safe.
Thank you.
Okay. While in-person events are not possible right now, the arts can still bring us together, and SU is leading the way using new technology to present performances this fall. Let's take a look at some of the events happening this month.